Our castaway this week is a writer of short stories, of children's books, and of screenplays, Roald Dahl. Could you adjust yourself to isolation on an island?
Very easily, yes. I look for it more and more in my life today. I hate to say it, but I would love it.
How much does music mean to you?
It means a great deal, but not in the professional way. In the old days, before I was married, I never used to start writing in the morning before putting on some very great music, like a Beethoven quartet, and sit and listen to it in the hopes that some of this greatness would rub off on me and that I would write better. As a matter of fact, it helped quite a lot, because it is impossible, after listening to great music, to write absolute rubbish.
Do you ever play it as background while you're revising or whatever?
Oh, goodness me, no. A little hut, curtains drawn so that I don't see the squirrels up in the apple trees in the orchard, the light on,
yes,
right away from the house, no vacuum cleaners, nothing.
Did you have any plan in choosing your record?
No plan. I just went to my record shelves and picked out one. One becomes, I think at my age, I could say at our age, couldn't I, very well aware of the ones one loves most, having played them a lot.
Right. What's the first one you've got there on that little pile?
It's Puccini's La Bohème with Caruso singing C'è gelida manina.
Il povera sa mia lieta sano da gran signore rimedini d'amore per sogni e per chimere e per castelli in aria. L'animo migliore, l'aria, la mia portiere, ruba le tutti i gioielli, due ladri gli occhi belli.
Enrico Caruso, an aria from La Bohème. Roald, you're from a Norwegian family.
Pure Norwegian, yes. Both mother and father, yes.
But educated in England.
Yes, born and educated in England. Mm. I speak Norwegian and have visited it nearly every year of my life. But I'm really very English.
English public school. Were you bright at school?
Not particularly, no. No, I was better at games than at work.
Yes.
Certainly no sign of any ability to write or do anything else. No, I was nothing at school. I wasn't even a house prefect.
You do quote in one of your books, your English report, indolent and illiterate.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes. I think the illiterate was a little bit unfair, because I used to read avidly all through. Indolent, yes.
What did you read? What were you fondest of reading?
Everything I could get hold of, from Dickens and Thackeray and, there was an American fellow who, when I read him, I couldn't turn the light off at night, a short story writer called Ambrose Bierce.
Oh, yes, indeed.
Who had a wonderful title to his collection, which was Can Such Things Be?
Yes.
And at age 11, I couldn't turn the light off.
A formidable writer.
Yes.
Now, you went off at the age of 16 on a travelling adventure.
It was 17, yes. We went on something that was then called the Public Schools Exploring Expedition to Newfoundland, mm-hmm, led by an intrepid and frightfully tough surgeon commander who was on Scott's expedition to the South Pole. It was enormous fun. It nearly killed us, you know, marching across Newfoundland and back with 110 pounds on our backs.
Wow.
Because in those days it was unexplored. Aeroplanes weren't flying around.
What did you want to be as a boy, as a schoolboy?
I hadn't the foggiest idea what I wanted to be. All I knew was that when my mother said... my father died when I was three, so my mother brought us all up. She said, do you want to go to Oxford or Cambridge? And in those days, you must remember, it was quite easy to get into them if you could pay. And I said, no, I don't. She said, what do you want to do? I said, I want to get a job that'll take me to distant lands.
And what was the first job that took you to distant lands?
That was the only job. I went up for an interview with the Shell Company for the Eastern Staff. And my housemaster, I remember my housemaster saying, I don't know what you're wasting your time with this for. There'll be people like the head boys of Eton and Harrow and God knows what there. But this imposing board of directors interviewing 60 boys for five places, they all brightened up when I said I'd won the heavyweight boxing at school. And that got me one of the places.
And where did it take you?
It took me to what was then Tanganyika, Dar es Salaam. Marvellous, you know.
Yes,
romantic, sure. Exciting. 3 weeks to get there on the ship.
And they thought your heavyweight boxing might be useful.
God knows what they thought. You know. I think behind their thinking lay the fact that you were fit.
Yes.
And you could cope.
Right. Let's have your second record. What's that to be?
The second one is a Beethoven, the violin concerto, mm-hmm. a part of the slow movement.
Why do you choose it?
Oh, it's just, I would choose masses of Beethoven if I could, because he's one of the great men, him and Bach. And I just didn't know which to choose, whether I chose a piano concerto or a quartet or this, but this is a fine record and played by a fine violinist.
Who is your soloist?
Yehudi Menuhin.
Part of the second movement of the Beethoven Violin Concerto, Yehudi Menuhin with the New Philharmonia Orchestra conducted by Otto Klemperer. So, you were in East Africa, you were only 18. What was your job? Was it an office job?
Well, it was a bit of everything. It was rather marvellous, a chap that age. You learned Swahili, you drove around and visited the sisal plantations and the diamond mines and things like that, see that the chaps had the right kind of lubricating oil for their machinery. You didn't know an awful lot about it. You'd had a six-month course. And it was so adventurous.
At that age, pretty terrific. Were you settled? Did you think this was going to be your career?
Yes, I did. Mm. I did, indeed.
How long did you carry on with the job?
Well, I was there about 2 years when the war broke out.
Yes.
And obviously, one joined up, so I got in a car and drove a long way through these, again, exciting, rutted roads and fording rivers up to Nairobi and joined the RAF flying training.
Did you train in Nairobi?
Yes, I did. Initial training. And then we finished up in Iraq, in a ghastly place called Habaneer, where the temperature was 120 in the shade, and you had to start flying at 6 in the morning and you finished at 9, and that was it. It was so hot.
You served in the Middle East. You were rather badly shot up.
Yes, I finished up in a sort of pile of flames on the ground. But I recovered from that and went on flying a bit.
Yes, you went to Greece. And you ended the war. You were sort of invalided out of active flying. You ended up in the United States as assistant air attaché, which sounds rather a glamorous post.
Well, I started up in that post. I didn't last very long because I'm a tactless sort of fellow, and that's the one thing a diplomat mustn't be, you know. I got shunted out of that, but I came back rather quickly working for the quiet Canadian, Sir William Stevenson.
Ah, yes.
In intelligence, yes, mm-hmm. Which was much more fun.
Surely. And it was while you were in that, in Washington, I believe, that you began to write.
Mm-hmm. I did. I'd never thought about it before, but as soon as I arrived in Washington, and one must remember that America was hardly in the war then, and we were trying to do as much propaganda as we could to get help from America. And I was sitting in my room in the embassy, and a door opened, and a little round face poked in with thick glasses and said, "May I come in?" And I really did think that this little man was going to ask for a job of some sort, not that I could have given it to him. And he said, my name is C.S. Forrester. And I said, oh, go on, you know. And he said, no, honestly, and being an avid reader, one of my gods was walking into the room. And he said, look, will you come out to lunch with me and tell me your most exciting adventure in the war? And I'll write it, and it'll be in the Saturday Evening Post, and it'll be good for Britain.
Yes.
And I said, yes, I jolly well will. And so we sat down, and we, having our lunch, we were eating duck. And he was trying to make notes and shovel this stuff into his mouth, and it was a mess, and I was trying to talk to him. I said, look, if I scribble this down this evening and send it to you, you can put it in proper shape. Would that help? He said, well, that'd be marvellous. Would you do that? I said, of course I will. And so I did, and a little story seemed to emerge from it, and I sent it to him. And a week later, I got a lovely letter from him and a cheque for $1,000 saying he hadn't touched it and he'd sold it to the Saturday Evening Post for me, and they wanted more.
$1,000 for an evening's work. Not bad.
Well, I said it can't be as easy as all that, you know. But it somehow worked. It was.
Right. Well, obviously, this was a terribly important evening in your life. Let's break off at this point for your third record.
Oh, Dylan Thomas, reading Fernhill. The greatest, to my mind, the greatest voice has ever been in broadcasting and the greatest poet of our time.
Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs about the lilting house and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honored among wagons, I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a time, I lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley.
Dylan Thomas, reading his own poem, Fernhill. Right, you wrote a number of RAF stories for the Saturday Evening Post, and very useful they must have been for the British war effort. Then you put those together in a book.
Mm-hmm, yes.
You're credited with inventing the word gremlin.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, it may be true, and it probably is, but I don't like to take too much credit for that. I wrote a little story about creatures early in the war, just after the Forrester thing.
Yes.
And it was called The Gremlins, and somebody showed it to Walt Disney, and he fell in love with it and was going to make a film. And in fact, I went out to Hollywood and, at his expense with RAF permission and stayed. This silly young man in RAF uniform staying in a suite in the Beverly Hills Hotel with a car provided by Walt and seeing him every day. Nothing much came of the film. They spent, I don't know how many $1 million on it and scrapped it. And that was the end of it.
But these were the original gremlins, the ones that used to get in the machinery and climb out on the wings and do all that damage.
Yes, and Disney drew the first pictures of them. And their wives.
They bred very fast. They began turning up in broadcasting almost immediately.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. Now, what happened to you when the war ended? I mean, you'd started writing, very successfully.
Yes, I was managing to sell more or less what I wrote then to big American magazines, and it seemed that as a single man I could make a living. Mm-hmm. And so I said to the Shell Company, I think I'll have a go and resign from you, and you better have all the gratuities you've paid me in the war back. They were extremely nice. They said, we think you'll need them. You better keep them if you're going to go into that racket. And good luck.
And from now on, you were a professional writer?
Yes.
Record number 4.
I once said to a professional musician in Washington called Mark Bitstein, what is the greatest musical work that's ever been composed? And he said, Bach's Mass in B minor. And I went home and I played it, and I must say I think he's right.
Part of the Agnus Dei from the Bach B minor Mass, a performance conducted by Herbert von Karajan. Now, your short stories, not very many in number, really, through the years, very ingeniously constructed, sometimes rather gruesome, often very funny. Now, because of the rather gruesome angle, they seem to pair rather strangely with children's books, which have been your other major output.
Well, I don't think they're gruesome at all. I only write, really, what I think is funny.
Yes.
One is an entertainer.
They're not all funny. Do you think they are?
Well, I've probably got a warped sense of humour, but I think it's terribly funny if somebody gets killed by being hit on the head with a frozen leg of lamb or something like that, you see. You can't really call that tragic, can you?
Well, it's a matter of opinion.
It's the old story about a man sleeping on banana skin. It's jolly painful, but we all roll with laughter.
Yes, it depends which side you're on, really.
Yes, it does.
How many books of short stories have you collected now?
I think 5.
Yes.
5, yes.
And how many children's books?
7 or 8.
Which have had enormous sales. In particular, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, which is probably your most successful, isn't it?
Probably, yes. Yes.
And it's been made into a film.
It was made into a rather crummy film, yes. I wasn't pleased with it at all.
Did you have anything to do with it?
Well, I originally wrote the screenplay, but I made the mistake of letting Hollywood have a free hand, and I shall never do that again.
Hold your breath. Make a wish. Count to 3.
Come with me, and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look, and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin. Traveling in the world of my creation, what we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, Simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world. There's nothing to it. No life I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. Simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world. There's nothing to it. There is no life I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly
another record.
The next one is another Beethoven. I didn't know which symphony to choose, but I've taken the ninth. Here's a part of the third movement of the ninth, the choral.
Part of the third movement of the Beethoven Ninth Symphony, the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Herbert von Karajan. Now, for many years, television has been after the backlog of your short stories, but you've said no. And now you've said yes, and indeed they have been cropping up on the box. What made you change your mind?
With all due respect, except for a few superb shows, like Upstairs, Downstairs, the quality of television is not very high, and I thought, well, I'm not exactly starving, and so let's hang on to them. Mm-hmm. And also, I had just enough sense to realize that a large package of them is better than trickling them out in one or two. And so I waited, and finally I thought I found the right people to do them, and agreed.
Have you scripted any of them yourself?
No, I don't want to do that. I want to keep away.
Now, since your Disney days, you have done a few scripts for the big screen. One of the James Bond films, for example.
That was fun. That's yeah. the only one I've had any real fun doing.
Which one was it?
It was You Only Live Twice.
Yes. You were inventing some extraordinary devices and whatever.
Yes, that was the fun of it. And it was Connery, Sean Connery's last one.
Yes.
He did. And we went to Japan. And you live in such luxury when you do a Bond. And you go in helicopters everywhere, tops of mountains and everything. Yeah, it's enormous fun.
You did Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
Yeah, that wasn't much fun.
Was it?
No. I better not talk. You know, you see, I'll start calling people horrible. But I'm not in love with cinema directors. Let's just put it that way.
Right.
Except for the James Bond one.
Yes.
Which was nice.
While you were living in America, you had the good fortune to become married to that excellent actress, Patricia Neal. Have you written any screenplays for her?
One, but there again, I think I'd rather not talk about it too much because...
It was one of those.
Yes, it was one of those. I don't think it was a bad screenplay, but things happen to Phil.
Yeah.
That's why it's so much nicer, you know, if you're an ordinary writer to to stick to writing books and stories, and nobody can screw around with them, can they?
Now, we know that your wife had a serious illness. She had more than one very serious stroke, out of which you did marvellous work in getting her to recover. As a result of this, you built up more or less a foundation, a group of treatment centres.
I didn't build it up. It was simply my original small idea of how to treat a stroke patient, yes, and give her a very intensive therapy.
Immediately?
As soon as possible after, yes, the stroke. The first few months are vital. But I called in amateurs to help because, yes, the English local hospital, they're all overworked and understaffed, and we were offered half an hour's speech therapy a week. So I said, well, that's no bloody good. She's going to need 6 hours a day.
And you gave her 6 hours a day?
Yeah, we called in the chums, and they popped in and out regularly, just like school. And it was very, very fierce and intense. And the final teacher we had, who lives in our village, who is an extraordinary woman called Valerie Eaton Griffiths, has taken this whole scheme up and allied herself with the Chest and Heart Society, which is now, I think, called the Chest, Heart and Stroke Society. And there are 30 branches, I think, in England, Wales and Scotland and Northern Ireland, each one with 100 amateur volunteers. They're ready to rush in to a stroke patient who's been, mm-hmm, discharged from hospital.
Yes.
It's working well.
It's very efficacious, I mean, if you start immediately.
The great thing, you see, a stroke patient doesn't want is to be left alone in the kitchen, staring at the ceiling. And what can the poor husband or wife or whoever the other partner is do unless they've got help?
That's marvellous work. Let's have another record. We've got to number six now.
Number six is the lovely Foray, a Requiem. And if we could have the Sanctus.
Thank you.
The Sanctus from the Fore Requiem, the choir of King's College, Cambridge, and the New Philharmonia Orchestra, conducted by David Wilcox. You have recently, at last, completed a novel.
Yes.
Are you a disciplined writer? Do you work set hours?
Yes, I am a disciplined writer. I don't think any writer writes particularly long hours because he can't. You become inefficient. I work from 10 to 12 and from 4 to 6.
Yes.
And then it's time for a drink. It's time for a drink after 12 and it's time for a drink after 6. Mm-hmm. So I hot-footed down from my little hut in the orchard and have a drink.
Do you work fast? How long does a short story take?
Anything up to 6 months. I'm a very slow worker.
Yes.
Very slow.
How long did the novel take, My Uncle Oswald?
Well, that was a short story, you see. About every 5 or 6 years, I decide to write another story about my wicked uncle, this mythical man. And I started a story about him, and I didn't set out to write a novel at all. It just didn't stop.
What are your other occupations? You live in the country. What do you collect? What do you do when you're not sitting in your little hut writing?
I'm pretty restless sort of chap. Don't like lying on the beach doing nothing. So I have a pretty deep interest in wine.
Yes, yes.
In 18th century English furniture. In pictures of all kinds, but mainly of this century. Plants and gardening,
yes.
Which has, in the last 20 years, has blossomed out into cultivating and breeding a certain kind of orchid known as Phalaenopsis.
You're also a gambler.
Yes, I've been a gambler all my life. I'll gamble, actually, on anything. Horses, dogs. I once bred racing greyhounds just after the war. I had 20 or 30 of them.
Successfully?
Not particularly, no. No, he was a gambler.
But that was the gamble.
He doesn't care whether he's successful or not, as long as he can gamble. Oh, it was enormous fun, breeding them and running them in little flapping tracks in the country.
Yeah.
But you see, all this gambling, whatever it's on, has allowed me to write 3 or 4 or 5, I suppose 5, stories to do with gambling.
Not from your gambling profits, but because they've given you the ideas.
Yes, yes. It intrigues me.
Right. Next record.
Bach again. The very well-known suite number 3 in D major. This movement, which you're going to hear, the air from this, is wonderfully well-known, but you must never call it, well, you haven't, but so many people do refer to great music, which we hear a lot of as being hackneyed. It's not. It's simply the greater the music, the more often you hear it.
Bach's Orchestral Suite No. 3 in D Major, once again the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra and Karajan, and this is the air on the G string. Now, you're a countryman. Does that mean you'd be an efficient castaway? Could you look after yourself? First essential, could you build a hut, like your hut at the bottom of the garden where you write?
I think I jolly well could, yes. As long as my health was good, I would be able to do it, yes.
Yes.
I'd love it.
And food. Could you live off the land?
If it was livable off, I think I could, yes. I'm a gardener.
Would you try to escape?
No, I'd love it. I'd absolutely adore it. I wouldn't escape. I'd stay there and hope that no smoke or funnel hove into the distance, you know?
Last record.
The last record has got to be a Mozart. I haven't had one yet.
Mm-hmm.
Another of the greats. I didn't know which to choose, so I've taken one of the lovelies, a sonata in A.
Alfred Brendel playing the second movement, the Minuetto, from Mozart's Sonata in A, Kirchel 331. If you could take just one disc that you've played us, which would it be?
Oh, it would have to be the B minor Mass of Bach.
And you're allowed to take to your island one luxury, any one thing of no practical use. What would you choose?
It causes great problems for a sybarite like me. The two things that I wouldn't want to do without is smoking and drinking. I toyed with the idea of a still,
mm-hmm.
because then I could distill my liquor. There'd be coconuts or something like
yes,
that.
Yes, that could be organized.
I could do that. Or a packet of tobacco seed, so I could grow the tobacco. Or even a bunch of cuttings from a great vineyard like Romani Conti in Burgundy and try to plant them, and then in time you would have the grapes forever.
Yes, that would take a few years, wouldn't it?
Yes, I'd be without drink until then.
I'd like
to have the still and the cuttings and the tobacco seeds, but I can't have them all.
Oh, pack them all up in a box, yes. They're all yours. And one book, apart from the Bible and Shakespeare, and we don't like big encyclopedias.
Well, I think it would, if you're going to be there a great number of years, it would have to be poetry. And the best wide-ranging anthology that I know of is the New Oxford Book of English Verse, compiled by Dame Helen Gardner.
Right. The New Oxford Book of English Verse. thank you, Roald Dahl, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.